Hey friends, welcome to the YouTube channel All About Electronics. So in this video, we will learn about the clock skew. So this clock skew is a phenomenon which is often seen in the synchronous digital circuits. So far, we have assumed that in the synchronous digital circuits, when we apply the clock signal, then all the flip-flops are receiving the clock at the same time. But actually, if you see, then the different parts of the circuit are receiving the clock at the different times. And this phenomenon is known as the clock skew. That means the different parts of the circuit are receiving the clock at the different times. So this can happen if the wires carrying the clock signal to the different parts of the circuit are of the different lengths. Or sometimes, even with the short wiring lengths, when the clock signal is getting delayed through some logic gates, then also we might observe the clock skew. Apart from that, when the different logic gates in the circuit has a different input capacitance, then in that case, the clock signal may arrive a little late to some logic gates which has a higher input capacitance. So these are some of the reasons for the clock skew. So this clock skew is particularly an issue when we are dealing with very large circuits or when the clock frequency is very high. And this clock skew is specifically a problem in the synchronous digital circuits. Because as you know, the synchronous digital circuits rely on the common clock signal for the operation. So if the clock signal arrives at the one part of the circuit too early or the too late relative to the other part, then it can lead to the errors in the circuit operation. So now, let us understand the timing constraints that is imposed by this clock skew. And let us see how the clock skew can affect the performance of the synchronous digital circuits. So in one of the earlier videos, we have already seen the setup time and the hold time in the context of the flip-flop. And we have also seen the timing constraints that is imposed by the setup time and the hold time. So during that discussion, we have assumed that there is no clock skew. And with that assumption, we did the timing analysis. But along with the setup time and the hold time, when we also consider the clock skew, then the timing analysis will get complicated. So here, let us see that. So here, I am assuming that you are already aware about the setup time and the hold time. But in case, if you do not know, then you can go through this video. But here, for the continuity, let me briefly explain what is setup time and the hold time. So the setup time is the time before the arrival of the clock edge for which this input signal must remain stable so that it can be latched properly. Similarly, the hold time is the time after the arrival of the clock edge for which this input signal should remain stable. So in that video, through one example, we understood that how the setup time limits the maximum operating clock frequency or the minimum required clock period for the synchronous circuits. So here, this TCKQ is the time after the clock edge, after which the flip-flop input will be available at the output side. So basically, that is the propagation delay of the flip-flop. Likewise, this TCOM is the propagation delay of this combinational circuit. And this TSU is the setup time of the flip-flops. So as you can see, here the minimum clock duration should be the summation of all these timings. So once again, here let us briefly understand with the help of the timing diagram. So as you can see, at the clock edge, this D1 input will be sampled and it will be available at the output after the delay of this TCKQ. Now this output will be applied to the combinational circuit and the output of the combinational circuit will be available after the delay of this TCOM. Or here, it is shown as the TPD. That means here, this new valid D2 input will be available after the delay of this TCKQ plus TCOM. Now this new input should satisfy the setup time and the hold time condition of the flip-flop. That means it should remain stable for the setup time plus hold time of this second flip-flop. But here, we are only considering the setup time. Because here, we are calculating the minimum required clock duration or the time between the two clock edges. So for that, we just need to consider the setup time. Because the hold time will come into the picture after the clock edge. That means here, during the calculation of the minimum clock duration, this hold time won't come into the picture. So we can say that the new clock edge of the second flip-flop cannot arrive before the addition of these three timings. So if it arrives before this time, then the second flip-flop will not be able to latch this D2 input properly. So this is the timing constraint because of the setup time of the flip-flops as well as the propagation delay of the logic gates and the flip-flops. That means this condition should get satisfied to avoid the setup time violation. Similarly, to avoid the hold time violation, this condition should get satisfied. So here, during that discussion, we have assumed that both the flip-flops are receiving the clock at the same time. That means the clock skew in the circuit is 0. So with that assumption, whatever is the D2 input that is present at the second flip-flop, it should remain stable up to the hold time of the second flip-flop after the clock edge. That means up to the hold time of the second flip-flop, this D2 input should not change. But if the propagation delay of this flip-flop and the combinational logic is minimum, then in that case, this D2 input might change before the hold time. For example, if this TCK queue is 1 nanosecond and this TCOM is also 1 nanosecond, then after the clock edge, the new D2 input will be available after the 2 nanosecond. So if the hold time of the second flip-flop is more than that, for example, let's say it is 3 nanosecond, then the input to the second flip-flop will change before this hold time. And in that case, the second flip-flop will not be able to latch the valid input. So we can say that this condition should get satisfied to avoid the hold time violation. That means the TCK queue plus TCOM should be greater than the hold time. Now in these two conditions, we have assumed that there is no clock skew. That means both the flip-flops are receiving the clock at the same time. But if there is a clock skew, then these equations will change. So let us see that. So in the synchronous digital circuits, there are two types of skews, the positive skew and the negative skew. So whenever the data and the clock signals are going in the same direction, then we will have the positive clock skew. So as you can see, here the first flip-flop will receive the data first, and then through the combinational logic, the second flip-flop will receive the data. That means we can say that the data path is from left to right side. And as you can see, here the clock signal is also flowing in the same direction. That means here, the first flip-flop will receive the clock earlier than the second flip-flop. So here, let's say this T clock 1 and the T clock 2 are the times when these two flip-flops are receiving the clock signal. So in the positive skew, if we see the difference between them, then it will be the positive. Similarly, when the data and the clock signals are flowing in the opposite direction, then we will have the negative clock skew. So in this case, the second flip-flop will receive the clock earlier than the first flip-flop. So here, if this TCLK2 is the time when the second flip-flop receives the clock and this TCLK1 is the time when the first flip-flop receives the clock, then the difference between them will be negative. So now, let us do the timing analysis of the earlier circuit using both positive as well as the negative clock skew. So first, let us do the analysis of the positive clock skew. So like I said earlier, in the positive skew, the second flip-flop will receive the clock little later than the first flip-flop. So now, let us see the effect of this positive clock skew on the circuit. So here, the CLK1 is the clock signal to the first flip-flop and the CLK2 is the clock signal for the second flip-flop. And the difference between them is the T-skew. Similarly, this TCKQ is the propagation delay of the flip-flop and this TCOM is the propagation delay of this combinational circuit. Likewise, here this TSU is the setup time of the flip-flop and this T-clock is the clock period. So without the clock skew, we have seen that the clock duration should be greater than these three timings. That is TCKQ plus TCOM plus T-setup. That means the next clock of the second flip-flop should arrive only after this time. But here, because of the clock skew, the clock edge of the second flip-flop will get shifted by this time. So here, if we see the difference between the first clock edge of the first flip-flop and the next clock edge of the second flip-flop, then that is equal to T clock plus T skew. So ideally, it should be equal to T clock. But here, since the second flip-flop receives the delayed clock, so this time will get increased by the T skew. So we can say that in this case, this T clock plus T skew should be greater than the TCKQ plus TCOM plus T setup. Or we can say that this T clock should be greater than or equal to this TCKQ plus TCOM plus T setup minus T skew. That means the next clock edge should only arrive after this time. That means in this case, because of the clock skew, the minimum required clock duration reduces. Or we can say that it is possible to operate the circuit at the higher clock frequency. So that is why sometimes this positive clock skew is also known as the useful skew. But because of this positive skew, we might face the hold time violation. So let us see how. So here, you already know all these different timings. So here, this TH is the hold time of the second flip-flop. So here, to avoid the hold time violation, this TCK Q plus TCOM should be more than this TSQ plus TH. That means whatever D2 input that is present at the second flip-flop should not change before the hold time of the second flip-flop. So if the new input that is coming from the first flip-flop arrives before this time, then the second flip-flop will not be able to latch the valid input. And during the hold time itself, the input to the second flip-flop will change. So to avoid that condition, this propagation delay of the flip-flop and the combination logic should be more than this time, that is TSQ plus TH. So if we satisfy this condition, then there will not be any hold time violation. So in this case, as you can see, since the TCKQ plus TCOM is more than this time, so there is no hold time violation. But if we have a larger clock skew and the low propagation delay in the circuit, then this condition won't get satisfied. And in that case, we might see the hold time violation. So with the positive skew, even though we are able to increase the clock speed, but we might face the hold time violation if this condition does not satisfy. So that is the impact of the positive clock skew on the circuit. So similarly, let us see the impact of the negative clock skew on the timing analysis. So as you have seen earlier, when the direction of the data path and the clock signal is opposite, then we will have the negative clock skew. So in this case, the second flip-flop will receive the clock earlier than the first flip-flop. So once again, let us do the timing analysis of the same circuit when we have the negative clock skew. So like we have seen earlier, without the clock skew, this T clock should be greater than or equal to this TCKQ plus TCOM plus T setup, where this TCKQ is the propagation delay of the flip-flop and this TCOM is the propagation delay of the combinational circuit. And like I said, this T setup is the setup time of the flip-flop. That means without the clock skew, the second clock edge of the second flip-flop should only arrive after this time. But here, because of the clock skew, the second flip-flop is receiving the clock little earlier. So here, to find the minimum clock duration, we need to consider the time from the first clock edge of the first flip-flop to the next clock edge of the second flip-flop. And as you can see, here this time is equal to T clock minus T skew. That means by this time, the new data to the second flip-flop should be available and it should satisfy the setup time requirement of the second flip-flop. So we can say that this T clock minus T skew should be greater than this time. That is TCKQ plus TCOM plus T setup. Or we can say that this T clock should be greater than or equal to this TCKQ plus TCOM plus T setup plus T skew. So as you can see, because of the negative clock skew, the minimum required clock duration increases. Or we can say that the operating frequency of the clock circuit will reduce. So that is why sometimes this negative clock skew is also referred as the harmful skew. Because due to the negative clock skew, the maximum operating clock frequency of the circuit will reduce. But here, because of the negative clock skew, we won't have the hold time violation. Because here, as you can see, the second flip-flop is receiving the clock earlier than the first flip-flop. So here, since the TSQ is negative, so if we see the condition for the hold time violation, then that is equal to this TCKQ plus TCOM should be greater than or equal to this TH minus TSQ. That means with the negative clock skew, the chances of the hold time violation will reduce. So in this way, both positive and the negative skew has an impact on the overall performance of the circuit. That means if the clock skew is not treated properly, then we might get an error during the circuit operation. So the question is, how to avoid or minimize this clock skew? So the one solution is, by providing the intentional delay in the clock path, it is possible to reduce the clock skew. So as you can see, in the first case, this buffer provides the additional delay to the first flip-flop. and in this way, it is possible to minimize the clock skew between the two parts of the circuit. Similarly, in the second case, to nullify or to minimize the effect of the negative skew, the additional buffer is added in the clock path of the second flip-flop. So to avoid the problem of this clock skew, the large digital circuits used to have a clock management circuit or the clock trees. So this clock tree or the clock management circuit evenly distributes the clock to the different parts of the circuit in such a way that the clock skew between the different parts of the circuit gets minimized. And in this way, the timing issues related to the clock skew are minimized in the large circuits. So that is all regarding the clock skew. So I hope in this video you understood what is clock skew and how it affects the performance of the synchronous circuits. So if you have any question or suggestion, then do let me know here in the comment section below. If you like this video, hit the like button and subscribe the channel for more such videos.